Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's episode of the Everything Went Black podcast. Please welcome back Paul Aloisio of Restless Spirit. Paul is becoming a recurring guest on this show because he's a cool guy, and we always have a lot of good stuff to talk about. We kick things off talking about the killer stuff that's going on with the band, tours, upcoming stuff, and then we take a flight into one of our favorite subjects, of course, horror films. We touch on Longlegs, a movie that everyone seems to be talking about. Before we get going, I want to shout out a group of fine gentlemen known as the Horsemen of the Podcast Apocalypse. Together, we wage a war against mediocrity. Kicking things off on Mondays, we have Brandon Legion's Horror Wolf 666, which comes at us twice a month. Tuesdays, Jackie Smith gives us Into the Necrosphere, the finest metal podcast in the land. On Wednesdays, we have Everything Went Black. I come back on Thursday, that is Necro Thursday, with the Necromaniacs Horror Podcast, along with Jeff Kachid and Mike Scandato. Friday, Spitball Media features Mike Scandato's brother, John Draper. Saturdays is a day off. Sunday, Carl Hikara comes at us with Soul Knox. And Carl and I are in the midst of doing our Darkness Weaves podcast, which is a show that is an add-on to both shows, where we talk about the work of Carl Edward Wagner. Our newest member, Cheyenne, gives us Iblis Manifestations. He has a new schedule. He comes out with episodes on Wednesdays. And that's pretty much the whole onslaught of greatness that we're deploying every week. If you want to support the show, definitely share this with your friends. Give us a like on social media. But you can also join the Patreon. As little as $1 a month, you get access to bonus material. For $5 a month, you get the bonus material plus early access. And for $25, you can become a sponsor. I'd like to say thanks to Braden, the newest returning member to the podcast Patreon. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. We have a bunch of stuff on there, weekly bonus episodes, as well as intermittent Zoom hangouts, which are a lot of fun. We're going to be planning to do one probably before the end of the summer or early part of the fall. Great hearing from you, man. I'm happy to have you back on the show. And as we were talking before, it seems like you guys have been very, very busy. So a bunch of tours, you know, it seems like the record's doing well. I follow you guys on Instagram. So I see all these shows with, like, you know, people there, which is, like, very cool.
Yeah, it's much different from the way that it used to be, you know, having people there, first of all. I mean, we struggled for, I don't even know, probably since longer than the pandemic, because we started in, like, 2016, really. We had a couple of different band names and stuff like that before we, like, settled on, you know, what the band is now. But it was just, like, years of kind of grinding and, you know, playing for nobody and just not really knowing, like, what's going on here. And then we put out Blood in 2021, I think, maybe 2020. I really don't remember at this point. But things just started getting, like, okay, this actually makes sense to keep doing it. And yeah, I mean, things have been going really good. We've been pretty decently busy. We just did those dates with Pentagram and Weed Eater, which is a trip. And yeah,
that is, seems like one of the perfect tours for you guys too. I mean, your sound and what Pentagram does, and even what Weed Eater does, like, you guys fit pretty snugly into that niche that those bands occupy.
Yeah, I mean, both of those bands were sort of, when we were first starting the band, you know, we were big fans of both of them. And those would be like, we'd be talking like, dude, wouldn't it be awesome to, you know, like, tour with Pentagram one day? Nah, that wouldn't happen. Or, dude, wouldn't it be awesome to tour with Weed Eater one day? Like, nah, that wouldn't happen. And so then it was like just back to back, like, two of those, like, bucket list bands. And I mean, yeah, the fans were perfect for that. It's kind of, I would say, especially with Weed Eater, like, I would say they're a little, I don't know how I want to phrase this, but okay, we'll say dirty. You know, their sound is just like filthy and like sludgy and stuff, and we're a little cleaner. But it still worked great because, like, the fans that go to like Weed Eater shows, they really just want to, like, I don't know, obviously smoke weed or, you know, drink a little bit and listen to some downtune riffs and stuff. So they were really cool, really receptive. And yeah, I mean, obviously no complaints with those tours. And we're very big fans of doing stuff with just bands that we like, and we don't really care if like they mesh that well. Like when we did that run with you guys, you guys in Cloak, like, I think our sounds fit pretty well together just because I think we could fit with kind of any band because we're all over the place.
Yeah.
But obviously it wasn't like just like a straight up doom sludge show or something like that. So when we do straight up just doom or sludge shows, it usually goes over really, really well. And you know, for a while I was kind of like, I really don't want to do too much of that because I don't want to like pigeonhole ourselves, but it gets to a point where it's just like, all right, I know that that's where the fans are going to be. So if we get the offer, obviously we're going to do it. And then, so even like when we go out and do just like some headlining stuff, that used to be really rough for us. Like nobody would show up. Just right. Straight up, you know, back in the day when you first getting started. So it's a trip now where you can go and play somewhere and it's like, oh, there are actually people here that know the band, they want to be here, and the room is kind of packed right now.
That's so a good, like, feeling, man. That's a great feeling.
Yeah, it's just, you know, just stay grateful that stuff like that is able to happen, because, you know, that's kind of what everybody wants that gets into music and stuff like that. Like, obviously, if you didn't care about playing two people, you just play in your room for the rest of your life. But we gotta get the sound out there and, you know, continue to grow so we can continue to do this. Because as you get older, as you know, you have to sort of start deciding, like, you know, your time here on Earth is not infinite. And you have to start making decisions like, is this what I want to spend my time doing?
Yeah, we were touching on that a little bit before we started rolling, but yeah, that's at some point you definitely hit that point in your life, and I was sharing with you that I've kind of hit that point too, where it's like, yeah, I want to be on the road, but not like the way I used to be, where it's like just anytime, anywhere, just go. You have to kind of assess like the value of doing it as a, you know, do like a breakdown of like, okay, is it worth it? Is it worth leaving home for like 30 days or whatever, and like, you know, what, how will that further our efforts as a band, you know, as opposed to just being like, you know, grab your gym bag and roll, you know what I mean? It's like, yeah, you know, that's how I live most of my life, you know, but it's like, yeah, you hit a stage and it's just like, okay, I want to balance things out, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like, and you also have to find things that you're happy doing at home, because for a while, when I was younger, obviously my 20s and stuff like that, it was exactly like you said, just like, who cares? This is all I do. And then I would hear about like people in much bigger bands, like Corrosion of Conformity, for example. Yeah. Pepper Keenan, I found out through like some interviews that he was renovating old houses.
Mm-hmm.
And in my head, I was just, you know, as a young musician, I was thinking like, Why would anyone do that? You know, like, I thought that musicians were just musicians. That's all they did. That's all they think about. But as you get older, you realize like your time at home is very important as well. And you have to fill that with doing stuff that, well, hopefully you could fill that with things that you enjoy doing. And, you know, you're not going to have the opportunity to be on the road 24/7, your entire existence. So you really have to do things that keep your mind and spirit in check and satisfied. Otherwise you're going to burn yourself out. That's just, it is what it is.
Yeah. And also like, even with like bigger bands, like you mentioned COC, you mentioned you know, Pepper Keen and those guys, where it's like that band has been through its ups and downs for sure, you know, and even like it's like, you know, as you know, music, it's a beauty contest. It's like so month flavor of the month sometimes, like so up and down, and people fall in and out of favor all the time. So, you know, I've seen big band, even Slayer, actually. I've seen Slayer in a room that only hold like 400 people, like in the 90s, you know, and they certainly have gone up and down. And even before, I saw them in Jersey and there was only like 100 people there, and it was at the PNC Arts Center. It was like during the week, and King Diamond was on the bill. And then a couple of years later, they're selling out these like huge coliseums. You know what I mean? Napalm Death band, like that's legends. See them play in front of 70 people. Then a year later, they're playing in front of like 1,000 people, you know? And it's like when you're trying to do this thing, like on that level, and it's not really based on your work output, it's based on how people perceive you. That's a rough road, man. So, you know, having to like temper that expectation sometimes and just be grateful that you're able to create and still go out and do these things, it underscores the fact that you have to have something else in your life that gives you fulfillment, you know?
Yeah, 100%. And I think also some people forget in this genre of music that it's supposed to be, you know, the underground. And there are going to be different subgenres that are more popular within this already niche music that come and go. So certain times, different subgenres are going to be more popular. And I'm sure you've seen that.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
But, you know, like, I remember thinking back when The Sword, you know, that band The Sword.
Yeah.
Just came on the scene. I was like, oh, this is like so like strange. Like, obviously I loved it, but like this band is just really going for that retro type sound. And it seemed like no one was really doing that at the time. And for a while, like every single band, it seemed like, was trying to get in on that sort of, you know, Sabbath-y, doomier type music. And then it just gets super saturated and people are sort of just like, all right, what's the new thing now? I mean, I saw that band, dude, when they were on tour with Metallica a while back.
Right, yeah, I remember that tour.
And that's just, you know, that was the fresh new thing, which is funny to say because they were going for a retro thing, but, you know, I digress. And you know, within this genre of music, what the fans and the people that are going to the show, people are going to wax and wane, I guess, in their interests. And so you're sort of beholden to that. Obviously, you'll have your diehard fans no matter what. But that's sort of like what you're saying with like Slayer. Like, I'm sure you can recall the time period where Slayer didn't even really want to do thrash metal anymore. And, you know, they were getting into like groove metal and down tuning and stuff like that. And you could say whatever you want about that period of Slayer, but it was just, you know, nobody was really in the, you know, the area of metal that Slayer existed. People were just kind of over that super fast, you know, type of stuff. So it's sort of just, it is what it is. That's really what I just break it down to. It is what it is. You can't control as a whole what people are into, but you know, if you want to keep doing it long term, you have to find things that you can be happy filling your time when maybe there isn't that much interest in the type of music your band is playing, or maybe you just get lucky and you just, you know, have your dedicated fans forever, and it sort of never goes out of style. Obviously, like bands like Metallica and stuff like that, but that doesn't usually happen. And that's fine. You know, that's fine.
I mean, it's funny that Metallica is probably way bigger now that, in my opinion, they're not a good band when they were sick. You know, it's like Metallica was only sick for like a small handful of years. And then now they're just like, I'm not a fan of what they do post Black Album. You know what I mean? And I understand that was like a smart thing for them to do, is to embrace whatever they're whatever direction they went into, because that became, they became like household names now, you know. It's like, but for me, my preference is like the Cliff Burton years, and you know, Injustice for All, and moments on the Black Album I thought are cool, but everything after that, I just can't get down with it, really. But that's what they had to do to have that longevity, you know. And who am I to say anything about that?
Yeah, and you know, bands like Metallica, or you know, Iron Maiden, stuff like that, like all of those, what's the word I'm looking for? Entryway bands.
Yeah.
You know, they are able to tap into something that young kids get into, and they're like, this is the greatest thing in the world. And when you get a music fan, especially a heavy metal fan, when they're young and they grow up with you, you got that fan like for life, because then it turns into a nostalgia thing. And I think that's one of the reasons why bands like that have been able to really kind of regain their popularity, if they ever lost it. I don't think Metallica has ever really lost it, but like, even they went through a strange period with like Load and Reload. I know Maiden went through their difficulties when Bruce Dickinson left. Priest, same exact thing. It's like,
They had Ripper Owens was a singer in Priest for a while.
Oh my God, I hate those two albums. I did. We did like, we used to do just discographies on tour of bands. Yeah. And the Judas Priest one was, those two albums I remember were just like mind numbingly bad. Like, I was like, I didn't think they were going to be that bad. I was like, it's Judas Priest, you know, it's, how bad could it be? But it was like, holy shit. I mean, I know those albums have their fans, but I don't understand it. I don't want to understand it. I don't care. I never want to hear those damn songs again.
Well, you know, even Sabbath, man, you know, talk about bands with their, like, you know, their lulls, you know what I mean? I remember specifically in the 90s when I lived in Boston, Black Sabbath played at the Orpheum Theater, which is like a, probably like 2,000 people or something like that. It was definitely not an arena. You know, and that was, I think, I want to say that like Tony Martin might have been the singer. You know, like, people forget that there is, you think of Sabbath, you think of Ozzy and maybe Dio, right? But
yeah,
people forget that for a whole decade, pretty much they had different singers. You know, there's like the Headless Cross, like record came out. There's Born Again with Ian Gillan from Deep Purple. Well, actually, that came out in 83. So, you know. But it's like, even a band like Sabbath, who people look at now as being like this arena band, you know, they came back in the late 90s into the 2000s. They did all those reunion tours. They played these massive shows. They were playing places like the Orpheum Theater. You know, it's a place I saw Anthrax at around that same time too. And it's like a small, for them, small venue.
Yeah. And I'm not sure what it is, but, you know, that whole, you know, final years of bands this big, there's like a push that this might be the last time you ever see them, all these legacy bands. So it's like, they'll play bigger shows and fans will come out of the woodwork. Like, oh, I've never seen them. I better make sure I see them now.
Yeah, absolutely.
It almost makes you forget that any of those bands were ever struggling at some point. You just think that they were huge their entire career, but that's just not the way that this music industry works, you know?
But I guess like one of the things that inspired me about those Sabbath shows in the 90s was like, you know, Tony Iommi basically created heavy metal. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so he already had like an entire run with Ozzy, was on top of the world, like creating this genre of music that people, has become this like legacy. Yeah, he had Dio in the band. Like, I don't think they were as popular, but he kept it alive during the 90s, man. Struggling it, banging it out. Different singers. Tony Martin, like some dude with blonde hair, or like another guy from LA. I don't even know the dude's name, but like I don't even know who the singer was at that show at the Orpheum. I don't think it was Tony Martin. It was some dude with like curly blonde hair that was the singer in the band. But he kept it going. And then it's just, there's something about that that's almost like this like kind of Nietzschean experience, you know. And I know that I over philosophize things most of the time, where it's like, you know, I like to romanticize all this stuff and like assign all this like value to it, where really the reality was probably like Iommi just like, you know, needed to pay off his like mansion or something, and that's why he made these records, you know.
Yeah.
But I want to believe deep down that there was like some kind of you know, commitment to art, or commitment to the whole mission that kept him going, you know.
Yeah, totally. And I'm sure that there's truth to both of those statements, which I'm sure is true for most musicians. But, you know, sometimes people aren't lucky enough to have that luxury, and it's sort of, they just got to take the knee. You know, it's like, it's not working. They have a family. They're just done. And I know people will look at that and be like, oh, dude, you're like a quitter. You know, you're not a lifer. But it's sort of like, you still have to live, you know. Are you really gonna? I mean, some people would disagree and be like, "No, I'd rather be destitute, you know, playing two people than stop this." But that wouldn't work for me, and I think most sane people it wouldn't work for. But
yeah, no, I think I'm on the same camp as you are with that. Not, you know, wanting to have an actual life as opposed to living in a shoebox somewhere on, you know, on the streets, you know.
Yeah. But some people are, you know, maybe they're completely happy doing this, and that's totally fine. But it's just, you know, it's where everybody's priorities are. That whole, you know, the idea of starving artists and stuff like that, to me, never really was that enticing. I mean, I live within my means to be able to do this. But I'm not, you know, at risk of being on the streets. And if I ever was, I'm not sure I would be so gung-ho on keeping busy. But that's just who I am. I know a lot of people, you know, would disagree with that. And they're like, oh, this is the only life for me. But I don't know. I'm a homebody as it is. So any excuse I could take to stay in my house, I will take.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's good to be at a point in a band where you could think like that, where it's like you love doing it, and it's like, all right, whatever we're doing is working, and you still need that drive to go and create, but it doesn't feel as much out of desperation that it did in the beginning. And I think that for some bands that's a bad thing, because then they just get formulaic. But in my opinion, at least for my band, Restless Spirit, we've done three full lengths at this point, a bunch of EPs. We have some stuff that's still not even released. But we've been lucky enough where I've proven it to myself that I could sort of just go in a room and write whatever I want, and it will end up working for the band thus far. So I'm lucky enough that I could experiment and say, well, this is just what I want to write, and not worry, will people like this? And honestly, I think Tunes is lucky enough to be able to do the same thing. I mean, you know, if you listen to your guys' first record to your most recent one, it's vastly different. And you're not playing to nobody. You know what I'm saying? Everything you guys write is highly enjoyable.
Thanks, man. I appreciate that. And like we're like in the midst of making new music right now too, which is like probably even more different than the last stuff. Oh, it's definitely more different than the more different. I don't know if that's correct English, but it's definitely it's not the same as past stuff. And so I like to do things differently every record and kind of move forward. And you know, we share that same sort of philosophy, you know, and that's not being like as big as like Metallica or, you know, probably allows us that, you know, that we don't have any kind of management, you know, quality control people over our shoulder and be like, well, you know, I think you guys got to change the verse here, you know?
Yeah. Fuck that. Yeah. And like, yeah, I mean, obviously, and I've told you this a bunch of times, like I'm a huge Tunes fan. And I love what you guys do. And even when we were on tour with you, I would watch you guys every single night. There are not many bands that I'll be on tour with, and I'll be like, every single night, I need to see them. They're that Dude, good.
I'm glad to hear that, because that was a rough time, man. That was like the very first, the pandemic technically wasn't even over at that point still, I guess, right? When we did those dates.
Yeah, like some shows, I remember we'd have to wear masks and stuff.
Yeah.
So it was a little weird. And you could tell that the vibe was just sort of, everyone was sort of figuring things out again.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that was strange for you guys because you've been doing it much longer than we have. So I could only imagine.
Well, yeah, it was like, you know, we didn't stop practicing during the pandemic. Like, we still got together a couple of days a week, you know, and which was real eerie, you know, like, because, you know, I drive down to the practice space and like everything's closed and you're not really even technically, I guess, I don't even know if we were like breaking a rule or law by doing any of that stuff. But I mean, it just was like you felt like you were doing some clandestine like thing by practicing, you know, because the building was basically empty. And we would just like be in our room, like doing our thing and, you know, being prepared for like when we actually were able to go back out on the road. And like that tour with you guys and Cloak was the first, that was like one of the first tours to happen, really, like after it was quote unquote okay to go back and do shows. And it just, I remember that first night in Providence, man, it was just like, holy shit, like I'm on stage again, you know?
I know, it almost felt like we were doing something like wrong. You know,
yeah,
like,
exactly. And like, you know, the muscle memory wasn't there. Like, it felt bizarre. It was like, but after the second or third show, everything was back to normal for the most part.
Yeah, those were definitely strange times. And the pandemic was, I feel like for a lot of bands, it was either a really good or really bad thing. Like, you saw a lot of bands just come back and just sort of be like, I don't want to do this anymore. But for us, I mean, obviously the whole pandemic was a horrible thing, but it was great for us creatively that we wrote Blood of the Old Gods, and that was the album that put us on the map and was like, oh, okay, these guys are actually worth listening to, because our first album just went completely like nowhere. It just flopped, got no attention. And it was like, I don't know, I guess people weren't what was it, that Back to the Future but it's like, yeah, maybe you don't get it, but your kids are going to love it. You know, it's like people just, but yeah, I mean, the pandemic, it was really a good time for me creatively. Everything else, it was just kind of boring. And I'm lucky enough that, you know, I don't know anyone that like died from it, but you know, not every band was that lucky. It killed a lot of people's careers. And, but you know, at the same time, maybe like we were saying before, possibly it could have just changed people's mindset on it. I mean, we've never had anything like that in our lifetimes. And possibly people just realized, hey, you know what? There's nothing wrong with just being a normal person and, you know, not going out and spending my life on the road. And I think that's completely valid, you know?
Yeah.
We're not robots.
Well, you know, it's funny. I definitely feel like different. Like, I feel like things are different after the pandemic, you know what I mean? And I guess the whole thing of being a normal person was like, I haven't been a normal person for most of my life, man. Like, as far as like things I've done or pursuits I've had, or, you know, I've always operated a little bit outside of a lot of that stuff too. And then suddenly you're just completely limited with what you can do. And I had to go into and I was alone through the whole thing too. Like, I just like moved away from, you know, my ex-girlfriend, and like, I was living out in Jersey by myself. And, you know, it was like, and then people died that were really close to me. And, it was just a hard, hard time, man. Dark, you know. And, some of the stuff on our new album I wrote during that period. So, you know, there's a little bit of that, but yeah, it just coming back after that, it definitely felt, it feels like, you know, like in the Marvel movies, like where there's like the multiverse, and like,
yeah,
there's like one strand diverges. I feel like we're on that divergent strand right now in the multiverse, you know?
Yeah, it is still bizarre. Like, I think about, for me, the pandemic was, it was like a break. It was like, all right, everyone in the world gets a timeout right now. And for me, in my own personal development, it was great because I realized how little I truly gave a fuck about anyone else's perception of me. Like, I never really cared to begin with, but then throughout that thing, I really realized I seriously don't give a fuck And it was, it allowed me to sort of take a step back and be like, what can I do with this even reinvigorated sense of, you know, individualism? But, you know, like I said, I don't expect that to be the same for a lot of people. There are a lot of people that have felt like it took years off their life. And that sucks, obviously. And I think that's completely valid, too. It's just, I don't know, that whole isolation really allowed me to sort of just go within myself and be like, well, this is the person that I think I should be. And when things are opening up again, let's see if I could keep this going. And I've been lucky enough that I've been able to do exactly that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the good things about the pandemic was this whole like horseman of the podcast apocalypse thing that is going on with, you know, with Everything Went Black, Necromaniacs, Into the Necrosphere, Horror Wolf, you know, Soul Knox. Like, we got this little crew. And that all came, all those relationships came out of the isolation of the pandemic. You know what I mean? Like, I became tight with Brandon and Jackie and Carl, all as a result of being by myself for 24/7, basically, and just reaching out to people and, you know, people having like admiration for the work that that we were all doing together. And then just forming this, like, you know, front of band of podcasts, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where it's truly, you know, and this may sound funny coming from, you know, a podcast based on people that are into like the darker side of art, but life really is just what you make of it. And if you took the time during the pandemic to just make it something better than what we were faced with, you're going to come out pretty good, hopefully. And it seems like you were able to do that as well.
Yeah. I mean, I try. I mean, nothing's going to stop me, man. You know what I mean? The only thing that's going to stop me is when I'm in the ground, honestly, dude. Like, I'm always going to find a way. That's just the thing I do, you know? But yeah, enough about that depressing shit, man. Like, so yeah. you guys have been super busy, which is awesome. And you guys got some stuff coming up at the end of August with someone, you know, my Eastern European friend is in the singer in that band. Persecutor. So yeah, I'm actually probably going to be along for at least one of those dates to see you guys.
Oh, nice. Yeah, we're doing two dates with Persecutor. Should be pretty cool. I know that when we did our full US, we were in talks to do some stuff with them in California, but it didn't end up working out. So I guess it's got to be one coast to the other with those guys. So now that they come, I think this is their first time on the East Coast, from what I understand as well.
Yeah, this is their first East Coast excursion for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, they're a great band. I mean, and they're on Blues Funeral, which is very closely, it's almost like the sister label to our label, Magnetic Eye Records. And they're just a great band, so I'm super excited to play those shows with them, one of which is the Decibel 20th anniversary kickoff party. So it's us, Persecutor, and Spider, and it should be a good show. Actually, both shows that we're doing with them is the same exact lineup. One is in Brooklyn and one is in Philly, so it should be a good time. Those two places are very good to us usually, so I'm hoping it will be the same for Persecutor, being so far from home and stuff.
I think I'm fixing to go to the Philly date, honestly, because just from where I'm at in Jersey, it's way easier to get down there than it is to get into New York City these days.
Yeah, it should be cool. I've never been to that place. Have you, Johnny Brenda's?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I played there. I played there a few times. It's actually a pretty sick spot. It's like there's like an upstairs, downstairs scenario. Parking sucks there. But it's like, the downstairs part is a pretty awesome restaurant bar, and they got great food there, by the way. And then the upstairs is a venue, and, we played there a handful of times. Pretty cool spot.
Oh, nice. Yeah. I've never even heard of it until this, probably just wasn't paying attention, but you know, I don't live that far to Philly, and usually if I hear about something going down, it's usually Kung Fu Necktie.
Yeah, that place is like, I got mixed feelings about that spot. It's like, it's always just a pain in the ass that dealing with that place. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't know. It's like a weird, the stage is weird. I don't know. We've played great shows there. It has nothing to do with that. It's just like the whole layout of that spot just kind of bugs me a little bit.
Yeah, well, I mean, it used to be 20 times worse with the, I don't know if you ever played the upstairs. It was like this weird L-shaped stage.
Oh no, I didn't even know they had a venue upstairs.
Yeah, it was a nightmare. Downstairs is, it's cool, but sometimes there's a weird vibe there. Sometimes it's great, sometimes not. But I don't know. I used to not really like playing Philly at all, but I like it now. Actually, since the pandemic, we've had some pretty good shows every time I've been there. I think the show, I forget what it was called on that first Tombs run, but it was like a restaurant. And you remember they built the stage like right before.
Oh wait, you mean like, are you talking about like back in like 2009 or something like that? Yeah, that was like the, I think it was called the M Room or something like that.
But what I was trying to say was the venue that we played on that first Tombs run with you guys, it was like
Oh
connected
wait,
to
you mean when we played together?
a
Oh yeah. Okay. Dude, I don't know why you're talking about something from like 20 or 15 years ago. Yeah. When you said first Tuesday, I thought our very first tour. I'm like, oh wait, when we all played. Yeah,
What
that
was that
spot
place?
actually was pretty cool. It's like a diner or some shit, man. I can't remember the name of it. It's like yeah, that place. I kind of thought that place kind of ripped, actually.
No, it was awesome and the food was great. It was just, it
Yeah.
was funny that like there was no stage and then we're loading in and all of a sudden there was a stage and I saw them like putting it together. I don't know if you remember that, if you were
Yeah.
looking out for that. That was super funny. But
Yeah, that place ripped actually. It's like the, I don't know, like Dream City Diner. I don't know. It's a funny name.
And it great food, but that's why I thought about it, because any venue that has great food, I'm excited to play there.
Yeah, Johnny Brenda's is cool. I feel like Philly does the same thing that New York does these days, where it's like there's a show early, and then like the DJ shows up at 11, and you got to be done by then. And that they throw you out, and then a bunch of like cokeheads show up to like dance, you know?
Yeah, I know what you mean. Vitus used to be like that quite often during the week. We'd be done playing, and then it was goth night, and
But
people just like filter in.
no goths. Like I remember the quote unquote goth night at Vitus, there'd be just like regular people would show up.
Yeah, just want to
Yeah.
party. But
Yeah.
yeah, so we're doing that. Before that, we're going out. Actually, starting next week, we're going out with our friends in this band called Horseburner, who actually are on the same label that Persecutor's on. They're like a more like Mastodon oriented, like progressive type sludgy doom. But those are good friends of mine, so that should be pretty cool. And then after that, we're doing no, sorry, before the Persecutor dates, we're doing this fest down south in Charlotte, which is always very, very good to us. And it's like sponsored by Does It Doom, which is pretty big in the Doom community, and there are a bunch of really awesome bands playing that. So that should be pretty sick too. But as far as things that I can be talking about, that's it. We have some other really fucking cool stuff being worked on right now, which unfortunately it's not ready to be talked about, but it's like kind of more bucket list shit for me, so.
Dude, yeah, I know the secret. So I, you know, and I'm actually pretty, I'm very excited for you guys, because I think it's once again another perfect opportunity for you guys to really you know, shine, you know. And I'm really excited for you guys. And and it's a band that I also have admired for most of my life, to believe it or not. And so I'm gonna try to make it out to at least one of those shows too.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome, dude. Are you guys doing that RPM festival too?
No, we did it last year, but we're not playing it this year.
Persecutor's doing that.
Yeah, so that's why we're only doing two shows with
Gotcha.
Persecutor, because then they're going off and doing that. I would love to play it again. That it was a really fun time last year.
Yeah, we played that too, actually, a few years ago. It was definitely cool. I actually had a lot of fun doing that.
Nice. Yeah, I like the I think it's in a different area than it was a couple of years ago, but from what I understand, this new area that it's in is supposed to be a lot better. And it's been my only experience with the fest, so I don't know.
Yeah, I mean that's aside from the mosquitoes, it was cool. But yeah. But so anyway, you and I are both huge horror fans, and we it's interesting because earlier we talked about like people who are very successful having to do things because they might have debts to pay, and Nicolas Cage comes to mind too as an actor who seems to be incredibly prolific. And I did read somewhere that he has a he had a huge debt to pay off, so that's why he was doing all these movies. But with that said, he's sort of in like I would say a renaissance in his career with some of the stuff that he has been doing that's quality over the last couple of years. And the one that came out recently is well, he had several movies come out this year, but the one that everyone's talking about is Longlegs, which you indicated to me that you'd seen that in the theater.
That movie has been on my mind for quite some time. And I don't know how you feel about it, but I really liked it. I thought that, whenever movies really have a lot of hype around it, I usually like to, going on like social media and stuff, and there's certain people, this is going to sound so awful, but there are certain people who like I know, and I just feel like their opinions suck on everything. Those are usually the people that are the most outspoken as well. But I was excited because a lot of those people that I saw talking about this movie didn't like it. So I was like, oh, I'm probably going to like it. But yeah, Nick Cage lately, the past couple of years, man, he's just been like, he's turning into like a modern horror icon, I would truly say. Who knows if he'll be able to keep this going. But I've really enjoyed a lot of what he's been doing, and this movie is no different. I mean, do I think it's the greatest horror movie of like the past couple decades? No, but did I really enjoy it? Yeah, I did. There was a certain atmosphere to this movie that I was really into, and there I'm but there are things about it that I like, and there are things about it that I didn't like. So I wouldn't say it was perfect, but I will say that it's been one of those movies where I saw it earlier in the week, and I thought about it every single day since I've seen it. So
Cool.
that to me is a good sign.
Yeah, I saw it down in Philly with Rennie, and we both have different takes on the film. I enjoyed it. Okay, that's my initial statement about it. Incredible atmosphere. I thought it looked great. In general, the story I thought was really cool. Nicolas Cage I thought was awesome in it. The one thing I have to say though is it did not. The actual film that I saw versus the trailers and all the promotion were different. You know what I mean? I thought that it was going to be this like bleak exploration of evil, you know? It did not really succeed in that level because there was quite a bit of humor in the movie, like, you know, dark humor, but you know, but that doesn't mean that didn't stop me from enjoying it though. You know what I mean? It was just like I'm like I had to readjust, reset myself, and be like, okay, it's this. It's like Oz Perkins's take on Silence of the Lambs, possibly, you know, or something like that.
I think I absolutely agree with you. The way that they presented it in the trailers and stuff like that, which that happens fairly often, I would say, in my experience, especially
Yeah.
movies that are like really hyped up, because it's like, how are you going to sell a movie like this? They got to think about that. And they really leaned into it being super disturbing. It felt like from the trailers it would be a little more like Silence of the Lambs than it actually was in terms of bleakness. But I don't know. There was the way that I would describe was just it was odd. There was an odd, unsettling feeling to the movie that I haven't really felt successfully in a while. And it's sort of hard to put my finger on what I'm actually saying. It just felt weird, which to me is good because I like a lot of weird fiction.
Oh, yeah.
As do you. And I got this vibe throughout that was just like, it wasn't terrifying. It was just weird in a good way. So when I say weird, obviously I'm talking about the weird that you'd probably be talking about, not just like, yeah. Oh, that was weird, dude.
I pick it up what you're saying. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. It had the other thing too, is I read a interview with Oz Perkins where he was saying that like he wanted to make a movie that people would, unlike his other films, which were like these kind of not so commercial, shall we say, like The Black Coat's Daughter is like this brooding, dark sort of film with not a lot of action in it, really. He wanted to make a movie that was kind of like a blockbuster, quote unquote. I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, wow, that's so interesting, because like that's completely not what he made, but it is in his mind. This is his attempt at making like a like summer, like, you know, hit film, you know.
Yeah, which also, you know, speaking of, you know, a summer hit film, it was set in the winter.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, also that whole vibe to me was really interesting. Okay, also to give my opinions on some of this, I'm going to have to give some spoilers. So anybody listening that doesn't want it spoiled, I would say maybe just skip to later in the podcast or just turn it off. So one thing that I found, I guess, funny, right, is that I do this all the time where I'll just be like, oh, wouldn't it be funny if this happened? And then it actually ends up coming true. So when the first conversation Lee Harker has with her mother, the very first conversation, I was like, wouldn't it be funny if she was either Longlegs or she had something to do with this entire thing? I was like, that wouldn't happen though. You know what I mean? And then it did. So that was kind of strange. So I kind of called the movie just like thinking, just out of the blue, like just a random ridiculous thought. That actually happens quite often, because sometimes I feel like the simplest explanations directors will go for are the ones that people are least likely to get. And I think that if I wasn't just thinking like, oh, that would be ridiculous, I probably wouldn't have picked, like, there was nothing that I was picking up on. I was just like, that would be ridiculous. But then the way that it ended up happening, like, I feel like the conclusion to the film and the realization as to what was going on, I think psychologically that's pretty disturbing. And I think that we're also pretty desensitized as to why it's disturbing. So it might not have landed as hard for a lot of people unless they really sat down to think about it. But let's just think about this for a second. So this young girl had a terrifying experience when she was growing up, and you don't know where her father is, right? I don't think they ever touched upon where he was the entire film.
I don't think so. I think you're right about that. Yeah, I don't recall them talking about the father.
So it seems like she has a reasonably close relationship with her mother. They seem to talk. She calls in the middle of the night when she can't sleep. It seems a little bit strange, but from that, what you could pick up on is that she possibly doesn't have that many people in her life, right? So her mother, they're close in their own strange way. And then it turns out her entire life was pretty much a lie, because her caregiver was involved in this insane satanic, I don't want to say cult, but maybe it could have been. As far as we know, it's only those two people involved, Longlegs and her mother. So she finds out her world must be turned upside down, number one. And then number two, she ends up having to shoot her in the fucking face at the end and kill her mother. And, seeing it on screen, you may not be like, oh, that wasn't that disturbing. Like, it wasn't that gory or anything. But, like, think about, like, what I just said. You know what I mean? Like, she had to shoot her mother in the face to keep this young, innocent girl from being killed. Like, that, I don't know, that's disturbing to me. And that, like, emotionally, there's a lot of weight to that. But it wasn't shown in a crazy bombastic way, and there wasn't this crazy struggle. Like, she jumps up, she's about to attack her, and she just shoots her, and that's it. And to me, even that's even more disturbing, because it was kind of just like one and done. Like, wow, she just killed her mom.
One of the things I was hoping the movie would get into, and they hint at it, but they never really, and this is probably, I mean, this is just me. It's not necessarily a bad thing. It doesn't make the movie unenjoyable, but they touch on the idea of a satanic cult and the idea of Satan and all this other stuff. And lately I've been in this space of thinking about, you know, what all this stuff means, you know, like the idea of abstractions and, you know, how powerful they are. And like, people think about God, you know, and God doesn't, gods exist because people believe in them, you know, just like a country exists because people believe in that. There's a border between Canada and the United States, or there's a border between the United States and Mexico. There is no line that delineates these two things. There's just an idea of a line, and it's an abstract idea, yet people lose their lives over these abstractions, you know? And like, when they first started talking about Longlegs being like satanic, I was like, this might be a cool opportunity to really get into like what all this stuff, like how these forces of abstraction sort of move people along. And it's like supernatural in the way that it exists outside of the physical world, but it's all part of like this collective kind of like idea. And that's, there was a moment in the film I thought it was going to go in that direction. And I was like, oh, this is very cool, because this is the kind of stuff I've been sort of like ruminating on recently, you know? And the idea when they had the dolls with like that cylinder in their head, but there's like nothing inside of it. You know what I mean? I mean, of course there's nothing inside of it, you know, but what, there's nothing, but that is the thing that takes the place of that void, is an abstraction which creates all this energy around it, you know? And I mean, I guess that's, it's a projection that I had, that the movie of course didn't fulfill that need, because obviously he's, you know, I didn't consult what Oz Perkins was, he was writing the film. Yeah. You know what I mean? But yeah, I guess I was projecting this onto that because I was thinking about that a lot, and I was like, oh, this would have been cool. But then it just kind of became like, oh, hail Satan. You know, I'm like, all right, that's cool too. You know, but yeah. I wanted a little bit more out of that.
I kind of liked that there wasn't anything, because at first I agreed with you. Like, yeah. I would have been like, oh, there should have been more. But then, you know, there wasn't any, when they finally catch Longlegs and they're speaking to him, there wasn't any like, this is my master plan and I'm going to raise the Dark Lord up. You know what I mean? He yeah. just says, hail Satan. And then that's the end. And you'll never get any more information out of him, because he smashes his face until he dies. So I was kind of happy that it was just kind of a little, the explanation for what he's doing really wasn't any grand, like, I'm summoning this, the devil. You know what I mean? I thought that it would have taken away from a lot. And I think that also a lot of people are going to either really like that or dislike that. Because it's sort of just like, all right, it is what it is. He's doing this for the devil, but you'll never know anything more than that.
Yeah. And it was almost like, you know, is it actually a supernatural thing, or is it just more like a kind of Ricky Casso, like heavy metal, like Satan? You know what I mean?
Yeah. And obviously Nicolas Cage, it goes without saying, his character in that was incredible. I mean, the fact that they even put all that prosthetic makeup on him for seemingly no reason, just making him look really disturbing like that, was awesome. The way that he delivered all of his lines. I also, I watched an interview on YouTube. I forgot who it was with, but he was saying his approach to that character was sort of that, you know, in life, he thinks that most people that are evil are not doing it to be evil. They think that what they're doing in some way is good, and it will better, you know, like there's a sort of righteous end goal, even if it isn't completely opposite to what all of society thinks. So he didn't go into the character of Longlegs being like, I'm creating an evil person. He tried to frame it like this person who was so obviously evil doesn't see himself like that. And I really enjoyed that. And I think that sort of came across, like, you still don't really know why he's doing it besides Hail Satan. but it sort of added like a deranged flavor to the character that I really haven't seen much in much modern horror.
Yeah, no, I mean, that was definitely cool, you know, because, yeah, I mean, he didn't think he was evil, you know?
Yeah, there wasn't. And I think that if at the end with the final confrontation, if he would have came and said his motivations for doing everything, I think if that happened, I probably wouldn't have enjoyed the movie as much, to be completely honest. I like how it was vague. And I think that adds to the weirdness and to the unsettlingness to it, because it's like sort of in life, like you're not going to get all the answers, even if you desperately want them. And yeah. Especially the fact that there are only two people involved, as far as we know, means that we'll never really get. Besides, like, the mother explains her motivations for it, but you still don't really know why. Unless I completely missed something, we still don't know why Longlegs did all of this. Unless I'm just completely wrong. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely a multiple watching type of film. You know what I mean? Like, I definitely want to see it again for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think at Necro, we're going to do an episode with all three of us on it.
That's sick. Yeah, yeah, you know, I was also happy to see. So I saw this movie at 4 p.m. on a weekday.
Uh-huh.
At this shitty local theater that I never really go to, but it was just the only one that lined up with my schedule. And it was packed.
Oh, yeah. So, no, yeah, totally. That's how it was when I saw it down in Philly. It was like, it was literally sold out and they had a second show. It was part of the Philly Film Festival.
That's awesome. So anytime something like that happens, I'm happy as a fan of horror to see, you know, especially I was like, oh, it's 4 p.m. Nobody's going to be in here. And it was the only movie I saw. There are a bunch of movies being shown at the same time. And I saw people in front of me and behind me all buying tickets for Longlegs. I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. That's a win in my book.
It's definitely a win for sure. Was there anything else that you're stoked about or anything you saw recently that was good?
Let me see. Honestly, funnily enough, I just watched Gladiator for the first time all the way through. And I was like, damn, this is a good fucking movie.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
So now I'm excited to see what they do with the sequel. And I know it's not horror or anything like that, but I was just – I don't because – actually, my mom is staying with me, and she really likes Russell Crowe. And we were talking about the sequel. I was like, you know what? Like, I've seen clips from the movie, but let me actually go back and watch the entire thing. And I was like, why? Once again, like, this happens to me all the time. I think we've even talked about this on the podcast. I was like, why the fuck did it take me this long to actually watch this movie? So that, honestly, that's the most recent thing that I could think that I saw that I was like, damn, this is awesome. I was just over 20 years too late.
They're making a sequel to that movie?
Yeah. So from what I understand, it's about Lucius, which is the son of the love interest in the movie. Do I think it's going to be good? No. But I want to see it just out of curiosity. And sometimes in the summer, I just want to watch something that's really big and grand, and Gladiator scratched that itch for me. But besides that, have we ever talked about Alien?
I mean, maybe, you know, yeah, I'm sure we have, but maybe not as a podcast or anything like that. No.
Yeah, yeah. So I don't know. What do you think about the more recent Alien movies?
I kind of dug them, to be honest, like, and not even as part of the alien world. You know, I like that panspermia idea, and I think the more recent Alien films are pretty well done, but I haven't seen the very, very most recent one yet.
Cool. Yeah, I think it's coming out midway through August.
Oh, okay. So it hasn't been released yet. Okay, cool.
So that I'm excited for. I haven't really, I don't know what it's about. I don't know who's in it. I don't know anything about it. And I don't really care because I'm going to see it regardless. So I'm excited to see what they do, especially going into it completely blind because I'm a huge fan of Alien. And that's pretty much it. You know, I haven't really had much time this summer to watch many movies because at the end of each day, I'm kind of just tired. So I go to sleep like a normal human being for once in my life. But that's about it. I mean, last movie I saw before Longlegs, I think, to be quite honest, was Dune Part 2, which I really, really, really enjoyed.
Yeah, that's a good one. I enjoy that one too. Yeah, I'm a fan. I only read the first novel. Like, I'm not a Dune reader, you know what I mean? Like, I never really got into the books, but I read the first one. And so I don't have any real opinion about whether or not, oh yeah, that's different from the book, or, you know, how like people go on about that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I read the first book as well. But I'm like you. I liked it. I'm not a Dune fanatic like I know some people are.
Yeah.
But I thought Dune Part 2 was awesome. And I think that's really it. Actually, I think one of the more recent movies I've seen, and I believe we have talked about this on the podcast, was Renfield with Nick Cage that I liked. But yeah, man, speaking of Nick Cage, I'm really excited and happy that he's really had such a renaissance in his career, especially the genre and the route that he's decided to take. And yeah, I hope we see more of it. You know what the thing is? And I say this all the time about him. He gives 110% no matter what. It's like he can't turn that off. So even if the script is awful, even if the movie is awful, you know, he's always so intense. And I know that he thinks he's an amazing actor. And I hope he always thinks he's an amazing actor, because if that's how you get performances like that out of him, I'm super on board. I really hope to see more.
I'm actually going to be doing an episode on Horror Wolf with Brandon about Nick Cage films. But yeah, so I'm going to go in more detail on this, but I think there are definitely like some shining moments in his career. And, you know, the Longlegs performance, Leaving Las Vegas, Wild at Heart, where he plays Sailor, Mandy, great in that.
Mandy is amazing.
Yeah.
Oh God, are you guys going to talk about Vampire's Kiss?
Probably. That's a great movie, man. Moonstruck, another great one. With Cher.
I've never seen that one.
Dude, it's got Cher, Danny Aiello. It's like an early 90s film. Really, really good, man.
I like it.
Yeah.
The Vampire's Kiss, when he's going through what the ABCs, right?
Yeah.
And he's just like screaming it. He was unhinged in that fucking movie.
Yeah.
You know what was great? Pig. Did you see Pig?
Yeah, that was another good one, man. And that very like kind of subtle like performance in that, you know, real good performance. And he was in that movie The Arcadian. Have you seen that? That's a kind of a sleeper that came out earlier this year.
No, I haven't even heard of it.
Yeah, it's on Shudder right now. It's like a post-apocalyptic film. These two kids are in it. You know, it's, I won't go into too much detail. They don't, you know, it's good. It's like a kind of monsterish vibe to it. And yeah, he plays like a dad to these two young guys, and solid, you know, solid performance. You know what I mean? And I think that like he rises to the occasion when he has a good script and a good director, you know?
Yeah. And you know, I think that's really what it comes down to. Like, he got a lot of flack for the Wicker Man remake many, many, many years ago. But it was like that whole movie was just kind of, what can you really do with that?
Yeah, I mean, that movie was a mistake to make even try to do that, you know.
Yeah, it wasn't good. And that gave some of the most ridiculous scenes I've ever seen, when he's screaming about the bees and it didn't work, but it was still Nick Cage just being Nick Cage, so whatever.
Well, the thing I want to say, going back real quick to Longlegs and Oz Perkins, I wish Oz Perkins had been the one to direct that most recent season of True Detective.
Oh, yeah.
Because people tell lies about how good that season was. And it was, I think, one of the most, like, worst, biggest pieces of shit I've ever seen.
Yeah, you really didn't like that. I remember you were talking about.
Yeah, dude, it's like, all right, a couple things. Like, in the beginning, the first episode, they have a fake quote from Hildred Castain, who is a character in Repairer of Reputations, the Robert Chambers short story that's part of The King in Yellow, for no reason at all. Like, they didn't, it's not even like a quote from the story. Someone made it up and attributed it to this character because somehow that would, they believed it would connect it to the first season somehow. And then the place is called Salal, right? And there's a short story by Thomas Ligotti called The Salal. And it's trying so hard to have it, to have meaning, yet that entire season was devoid of any real meaning at all.
Not only that, I was kind of liking it in the beginning, but then we were talking about it and you were like, yeah, dude, like the season is almost over and nothing has happened.
Yeah.
That like blew my mind because I really thought the fact that nothing was happening, I was like, oh, this must be like a decently long season. And then they just wrapped it up within like even like on a base level, like taking everything you just said into consideration, throw that out the window. But the fact that they just wasted so much time was like, why? What was the point of this?
Yeah.
It was like they had an idea for three episodes and they padded it out to six or seven or eight. You know what I mean? It was ridiculous.
And they like, you know, really spent so much time on meaningless things like these, you know, the ridiculous personal lives of the characters, which weren't even interesting. You know, it's not like there was anything that compelled the story forward that we gleaned from any of their social lives or any of their interactions or, you know, the all these like completely predictable things that were going on in their lives, you know. And then if you say you don't like it, you're a misogynist, you know. It's like, oh, I didn't really like it that much. Oh, you hate women, you know. It's I'm like, no, I just didn't like this show, you know.
Jodie Foster is great, and I was just surprised that it was like, how are they making me hate her so much? It's like,
I know,
we get it. She has a problem with men, and she's a homewrecker in this season. Can we move on, or can this connect to something? And it just never did.
Not at all, you know. And like, yeah, there was no, there was just nothing interesting about it, you know. And furthermore, they just on they have all these like surface connections to like weird fiction, which were like, all right, cool. You read the bibliography of Noctuary and you pulled that title out from Thomas Ligotti, and then you thought that the name Hildred Castain was cool, but then you wrote a blurb that wasn't even part of the short story and attributed to him. And then why?
That's
like,
insane.
Why does that name come up? Like, but it's like, was there any connection to anyone named Hildred Castain in the entire show? No. Like, it would have been cool if they had a character named Hildred Castain or made references to someone or made references to like the actual King in Yellow play and how that makes people crazy. And that's why the murders happen. You know what I'm saying? Like, but there was nothing, there was no substance. It was all flashy, like all surface. You know what I mean?
They've just been trying to catch that high of the first season since it came out. And it's like, I feel like they keep trying that hard. It's never going to happen.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like really disappointed, but that, like, once again, someone like, you know, like Oz Perkins would have been great for that, you know.
Yeah, I would definitely agree with that. It was a good premise, I thought. Yeah. It just fell completely flat by just having nonsense throughout the entire season.
Wait, was it called? It was True Detective. Was it called the Nightland?
Night Country.
Night Country. All right, yeah. Because even the Nightland is like a William Hope Hodgson novel. Weird fiction novel about actually it's a sick book if you ever want to read something. It's takes place in the distant future when the sun's gone out and the world is in total darkness. And everyone lives in these like underground in these like pyramids and stuff. And there's like this love story that goes back to like the Baroque times. And it's really fucking cool, man. It's like one of the greatest pieces of weird fiction ever written.
I'll have to check that out. I've actually been meaning to find something this summer to read on my free time.
I'm not saying this like in any way, but like it's kind of difficult to read because it uses this kind of like weird colloquial like vernacular. Like the writing is like kind of hard to decipher sometimes. But definitely go for it, man. It's good.
Yeah, I'll try and check that out.
I mean, I actually recommend reading that. And he has another novella called House on the Borderland. And in my mind, both of those stories are connected. Yeah. So if you House on the Borderland is a lot easier to get through. It's like a very, it's like written like a normal story. But yeah.
Yeah, I'll have to check those out for sure. I've been really slacking on my reading. Basically because there's been no tours this summer. When I'm on tour, it's just like when I'm in the van, I just read and read and read. There's nothing else to do.
Yeah, no, I hear you, bro. Yeah. But yeah, dude, it was great talking to you. And I'm excited. You know, I'm happy. Happy that things are going well with the band. And you know, I'll be checking you out at the end of August.
Hell yeah, man. Excited to hang out. And thanks as always for having me. Like, love coming on the show.
Yeah, dude, it's a blast always having you on, man.
All right, I'll see you in a couple weeks, I guess.
Yeah, man. Take care.
Later.